carbon is all around us, you can really take that atmospheric CO2 and turn it into anything you'd like.
We should think of carbon as a precious resource. Everything we use, everything we need is provided by carbon. Let's imagine an airplane today. What if a steel mill gas could be recycled to make everything on that plane, from the fuel to the seats? Imagine a future where a steel mill gas can be a Lululemon pair of running shorts. A future where there is no such thing as waste.
We need a portfolio of solutions, and we need to mature all of them really, really fast,
scaling them simultaneously all around the world.
Captured carbon, can it really be worth something? Or is this just a pipe dream? And crucially, can innovation keep pace? Carbon is the very foundation of life, found in everything from humans to microbes.
We will always need carbon for our materials, even if we get rid of all fossil carbon from power production, even if we somehow manage to stop carbon in aviation fuel. You're still gonna need carbon for the things you wear. And so the problem isn't carbon, the problem is how we dispose of carbon.
Since the Industrial Revolution, we've been digging up fossil fuels relentlessly, driving everything from energy to everyday products. Now we're at a tipping point. There are, however, innovative solutions popping up to handle this carbon overflow.
Hi, my name is Galorem Turan, and I'm the Chief Impact Officer at the Global Carbon Capture and Storage Institute. Carbon capture, storage, and utilization is a set of technologies that involve capturing carbon dioxide either from large emission sources, such as power plants or industrial complexes, or from the atmosphere itself, storing the CO2 deep underground or converting into product so that it could be stored durably and taken out of the atmosphere. It is a bit like the Swiss Army knife of climate technologies. Currently, we have 50 operational facilities around the world that have capacity to capture and store 50 million tons of CO2 per year. We need to get from where we are today, scale it up by 100 times by 2050. And I know that it sounds daunting, but we don't have any time to lose, and we've got to deploy every solution that we have available today.
Yet here's the catch. Fossil fuels are still being pulled from the ground to feed the massive demand. So the question is, can this endless road of take-make-waste truly be transformed?
My name is Jennifer Holmgren, and I'm the CEO of LanzaTech. We need to transition to carbon recycling, enabling us to create a circular carbon economy. Whether it be with apparel or tires, these things will not need to be thrown away because we have a path by which to put them back into the economy. So your running sneakers become tires, or your tires become your dress. The real vision is to just keep carbon in circulation and not be in a position where we need to take fresh carbon out of the ground.
There's lots of exciting ways we can put the carbon to work. We want to look to places where we can put carbon at scale.
Here's where things get interesting. All over the world, entrepreneurs are racing to pull off what feels like science fiction. Can they push the boundaries of what's possible before it's too late? Carbon engineering uses a technology called direct air capture, which draws carbon dioxide directly out of the atmosphere.
We take it out of the atmosphere and we put it back safely underground. But we can also turn that atmospheric carbon into low carbon fuels, actually recycle the carbon.
Creating fuels with captured carbon dioxide is an ingenious way to reduce fossil fuel extraction. Blue Planet Systems is deploying a process that embeds carbon into concrete. This permanently locks the carbon into rock.
So we're capturing the CO2, bringing flue gas from the power plant where the CO2 would have gone into the atmosphere.
They take it from power plants, send it through gas lines, process it.
And it comes out the back of the rock. We're using these rock as aggregate in the concrete. But these are 44% carbon dioxide that's permanently crystallized.
LanzaTech's even using microbes to turn carbon into ethanol, which goes into everything from jet fuel to clothes.
The way our process works is just like a brewery. Instead of using sugar and yeast, what we do is we use these waste gases that are then converted to ethanol with a bacteria. This ethanol is then put into the conventional petrochem supply chain that allows you to make polyester. This is a pair of H&M training tights. And the polyester here was made from a recycled emission at a steel mill. This is a Zara dress that was also made from recycled pollution, an Adidas jacket, and a Krag Hopper's fleece. Our goal is to continue to grow the business, to partner, to integrate into facilities to capture their CO2 and convert that into products. We're just starting up our plant in Georgia to produce 10 million gallons of sustainable aviation fuel.
But the question remains, can these mind-bending technologies scale up quickly enough? And will they actually make a dent?
Experts estimate that we're going to need to remove 10 to 20 billion tons of CO2 from the atmosphere every year. It's actually going to take all of the technologies and all of the natural solutions that we have out there. And at Carbon Engineering, we're excited about regulated markets that are opening up for carbon products.
For us, the immediate next steps are to deploy. There's a lot of things that are required to increase deployment. I think the most fundamental is the capital, the financing to build first-of-a-kind projects. The cost premium of building these first-of-a-kind projects is too high. We need partners who are willing to say, I am going to be first. We need people to say, I want to buy the first carbon recycling unit. I know it's more expensive, but I will enable a future that is better by doing that. We shouldn't be slowing down new ideas. We should give them an opportunity to scale and to prove themselves. Every time I reuse a carbon atom that's already out of the ground, I keep another permanently in the ground where it belongs. One of the misconceptions is how long will that reused carbon stay in circulation? We can permanently capture carbon in products. And the reason we can do that is because a product like a Zara dress goes back to the store and it's reused. And it can be reused to make another Zara dress, or it can be reused to make a pair of shoes. So my end of life is a recycling machine.
Carbon capture comes with a high price tag. Is this idea of a circular carbon economy really within reach?
My name is Gaurav Sand, and I'm the Pritzker Professor of Sustainability at UCLA and the founder of Aquatic. The management of carbon dioxide is not a scientific challenge. It's in fact an economic challenge. How do you do it cheaply enough is really going to be the defining question that we seek to answer. If you're both accomplishing carbon removal and you're able to actually produce valuable co-products with the process, subsidize the cost of carbon removal, which makes it affordable. This is really an important part of what it'll take to come to scale.
Carbon recycling creates a new carbon economy because it fundamentally stops us from using only our current fossil system. The ability to use waste carbon to make food, fuels, chemicals, it's becoming a reality. There is demand both in the carbon abatement side as well as in the use side. The more we deploy, the cheaper it gets.
If we are to scale up from where we are today to where we need to be, we need to have suitable business models for the private sector to invest in this technology. We will need an investment in the magnitude of $1 trillion potentially or more between now and 2050. I know this sounds like a large number, but I would say, what is the price or the cost of a habitable planet?
But is the inertia to shift our fossil fuel-based system too great? What'll it take to make a change that sticks?
I think demand signals and pressure are what's going to create investments. The most fundamental question is, where does the carbon in my stuff come from? If you're looking at labels, if we're saying, is this recycled or not, before you buy it, we will create the demand that will enable all of the recycling to grow.
Governments have a key role to play, putting in place supportive policies so that the businesses can invest with confidence.
Here's the crunch. To make this dream real, we need measurable results, something to show it's working. Without it, the funding, the momentum, stalls.
Monitoring the removal of carbon dioxide is fundamentally important. We want to know exactly how much we've removed. This is important not only to know how well a process works, but also be able to enhance the confidence of society at large in that we are indeed accomplishing what we are saying we are.
What should we be measuring? We should be measuring carbon in our atmosphere. We should be measuring how much carbon we're reusing. We should be measuring how much carbon we're putting back in the ground. Those are the right measures.
As a person on the planet and as a mom, I want to give back future generations a healthy planet with a safe amount of atmospheric CO2. As a company, we believe that humanity can solve climate change, and we're so excited to bring new technological tools to the toolbox and be working with people across the globe who want to implement that new clean infrastructure to help solve climate change.
We need to deploy every possible solution in our toolkit in order to address this challenge.
Our mission of carbon recycling has now spread, and a lot of people are starting to talk about it. We're very excited to have contributed to an industrialized world where carbon gases are being reused. And now we're doing it at commercial scale, and we're also making materials at commercial scale. We're doing it.